this transition that Islamic architecture achieved during the Mamluk era is represented in the Mosque of Sultan Hassan in Kelso Square in Cairo, an area which has become a home of many of the great architectural structures, starting with Saladin's famous castle east of this location.
We are now in the square formerly known as the Romana Square, which lies in front of Saladin Al-Ayyubi's castle and is overlooked by a number of extraordinary mosques. First is the Mosque of Sultan Hassan, the construction of which took many years and came at a great financial cost. Many folklore stories revolve around it. Antiquity specialists say that the minaret with its shape and height is similar to the entryway of the Karnak Temple, which is full of great gates and large, tall pillars.
The Sultan Hassan Mosque came at a peak of Islamic Mamluk architectural age, even though it is not among the last of the mosques to be built. The reason that it is dubbed as that is that it has reached, in its standards, as close as a structure can get to architectural perfection, encompassing all of the descriptors that would qualify for this status, such as the grandeur of the structure, precision of design, and the wonderful craftsmanship.
If we look at the Mosque of Sultan Hassan, which is the epitome of Mamluk architecture, we find that the outer design of the mosque is not the usual rectangle or cube, which we see in most Islamic countries. What we see is an important and significant jutting forward of the entryway in the Sultan Hassan Mosque. This feature serves to make any passerby aware of the presence of an important architectural structure. In this case, the mosque. With this simple movement of the entryway, the structure, or the mosque, makes the passerby aware or notice that this mosque is not there for a separate entity, but is rather there for the benefit of the passerby himself. An important dimension in what is today called urban planning or design. And that is, when one designs a building, it should be designed to fit within the context it is built in, not as a separate entity.
Sultan Hassan ibn al-Nasr Qarun is one of the Bahri Mamluk sultans. Brought together the most famous architects and builders of his time from many different countries, charging them with the task of building him a mosque that would be different and bigger and more beautiful than any other mosque ever built. 7 years of collaborative efforts brought forth this unmatched architectural masterpiece. Their work began in the year 757 Hijra and ended in the 764th Hijra year, but was built between 1356 and 1363 CE.
The monumental proportions with which the mosque was designed and built is indicative of the importance given to education in the first place, and can also be attributed to the fact that Mamluk sultans did not come from Arab backgrounds, and the one way they could rule over the Arab Islamic regions was through religion. So, the building of mosques of this magnitude on the inside and outside gave them a religious superiority in some sense. This is why these mosques, with their monumental exteriors and intricate interiors, were first found during the Mamluk era. The interiors are characterized by the Iwan style of mosque, which is distinctly a Mamluk style. On the outside, it is their attention to detail, especially when designing entryways.
The Sultan Hassan Mosque measures at nearly 8,000 meters squared. It is home to a magnificent gate, which is considered one of the greatest in all Islamic architecture. Looming at 38 meters high, the mosque has two minarets, one in the south and one in the east. The original design of the mosque included four minarets, one on each corner. But many circumstances did not allow for this to happen. The architectural style of this mosque is that of Iwan Mosque, meaning the building is divided into large chambers, each of which performed a specific
not only ours, but was also a madrasa, known as the Madrasa of Santa Anasa, a school which was in place for many centuries and was run by representatives of all four sects. Each of the great sultans made sure a mosque that would be state-safe was built. Madrasas were added to ensure the prosperity and continuation of the establishment. The four schools represented the sects of Hanafi, Shafi'i, Maliki, Hanbali, and remained the main educational institution in Egypt until the Ottomans came along.
Having representatives of the four sects meant that mentoring or learning went on in different groups, and instead of having all the groups housed within one large space where the noise would possibly disrupt the learning, the different chambers or imams were established, one for medicine, another for astronomy, and so on and so forth. Historians also say that the four chambers were built to accommodate the four sects. Either way, we know that all scholarly endeavors were taught through the framework of jurisprudence. Having these imams as independent states was a feature that did not exist outside of the Mamluk era.
The Qibla Iwam in the Sultan Hassan Mosque is the largest, with its depth measuring as much as the size of the courtyard, nearly 33 meters. Its walls are decked out with marble and colored stones, with a line of Quranic verses going around it. At its forefront is a niche embellished with marble and gold engravings. Atop this iwan is a massive dome, considered one of the largest domes in similar architecture.
If we enter the courtyard of the Sultan Hassan Mosque, we found ourselves surrounded by the four iwans, the most important being the Qibla iwan, which houses the prayer chamber. We will find that gaining access to the courtyard is not through any of the iwans, giving each iwan an independence of the structure as a whole.
I find that unnecessary to talk about the intricate details of the architecture of this magnificent mosque, which inspires awe in all those who visit it, whether they are local or foreign, because of the superb embellishments and the immense entryway and the beautiful niches. The beautiful clocks and the ventilation system, a true masterpiece which reflects the greatness of Muslims and their architectural style and abilities.
There are many other Mamluk mosques in Cairo which are representative of different phases of that era. Most of the mosques, however, have been built in the style of the Iwan Mosque. Many of these mosques can be found in old Fasmid, Cairo, especially on Al Mawaya's Medina Kala Street.
On the Al Mawaya's Medina Kala Street are many buildings relevant to the history of Islam. More than 60% of the antiquities of Fatimid Cairo can actually be found on Al Mawaya's Medina Kala Street. And it is thus said that it is one of the largest and most important historical streets in the entire world, meaning it is ranked the first or second street in terms of the number of antiquities.
On the Al Mawaya's Medina Kala Street, the name Kalawun is repeated many times, as many men from that family were in power during the Bahri Mamluk era. It is in this street that the dome of Al-Mansur Kalawun lies, only to be overshadowed by the size of the Mansur Kalawun architectural complex next to the Bar Kook Mosque. A madrasa forms the major part of the structure.
Mamluk architecture is what brought the new style of a compartmentalized mosque, offering different facilities in addition to being a house of worship with a multi-purpose prayer hall. These new structures depended on the planning of the Iwan or chamber structure inspired by Iranian or Persian architecture, all of which was employed to allow for each of the services of a mosque to have their separate space once
Saint Bartholomew complex dates back to the year 826 Hijra or 1424 CE.
Warren and Moes begin at our street. To my left is the Akbar Mosque. Behind me is the Saladar Mosque. In front of me is the Sultan Kamal Mosque. And then the Balawal Group. Near the end of the road is an important historical mosque, which is the Mosque of Sultan Ashraf Barsbey, where most of the major events of the Sultan's life took place. And as you know, he's one of the most important Mamluk sultans.
This mosque's entrance in Madrasa, lying near the Qibla vestibule, overlooking Al Mawahir's Ibn Allah Street. It is decorated with high marble and is covered with conical shapes. The Qibla Iwan in this complex is the largest, with a dome attached to it from the northern side. This pulpit is bustling with different types of Islamic inlay decorations, much like the pulpit constructed in the 9th Hijra century. At the current intersection of Al-Azhar Street and Ma'ayas Lidin Allah Street lies what is the last of what was built in the Mamluk era, and that is the complex of Qamsua al-Gawi.
We are now in the center of Al-Ma'ayas Lidin Allah Street, overlooking the Gawri Group, starting with Al-Gawri Dome, which is part of Al-Gawri Palace, a palace built using marble columns that came from people's homes. Every sultan or ruler would ensure that
which splendid design.